So you've picked up Rome 2, or you're thinking about picking it up on the summer sale, but you want to know what to do first. Well, first a couple of comments why I think Rome 2 is a good pickup on the summer sale. For $15, there's quite a bit of content in the base game. Do be aware that the game, even at 75% off, has $50 worth of DLC. Yes, this game has a ton of DLC. Now, do you need that DLC to enjoy the total game? Not really. I think for $15, the base game is a great place to start and see whether you like things. And then, of course, you know, if you wanted to, you could pick up a couple of DLC or something in the sale that's of particular interest to you. So, first of all, let's talk about a few basic things that people want to know for Total War Rome 2. The system requirements for this game are very low. I'm going to cover those just real quick. So, Total War Rome 2 was released on September 2nd, 2013. A lot has changed in the world of computer hardware since then. While all Total War games typically may require a pretty solid gaming computer to run on the highest settings, many people aren't familiar that you actually can run these games, especially when older, on machines that aren't brand new. And I think, again, that's the reason why Rome 2 might be a great deal here. So listen to these minimum system requirements. Now, I'm not saying the game would look great, but it would be playable with even a 2 gigahertz Intel dual-core processor, 2 gigabytes of RAM, 512 megabytes, yes, megabytes, of DX9, so yes, that's very old, right now we're on DX12, graphics compatible. I mean, I had this thing run years ago on a touchscreen laptop that didn't even have a dedicated GPU, so it was running off of the Intel HD graphics, and that was years ago. Was it on low settings? Yeah, it was on pretty low settings. Didn't have really high frame rates and stuff, but I could play it, and it was fine, and I did play it on that laptop quite a bit. So, I don't even think you have to have a dedicated graphics card to pull this off. Again, just be sure when you look into it, but I'm pretty sure that most folks with anywhere a computer in the last 5 years can probably run this game relatively safe. Now, that said, check it out. And now, recommended is obviously a bit higher. They want you to have at least a second generation Core i5, which is a quad-core processor. And that second generation i5, I mean, those were released probably 10 years ago or more. So again, this is a pretty easy requirement to meet. 4 gigabytes of RAM, again, a pretty easy requirement to meet. And then a gigabyte of DX11 compatible graphics. So almost any dedicated GPU out there that has been created since 2013 would probably do the job. So it doesn't take much, okay? So again, the requirements from a system standpoint are pretty low, which means that most people should be able to run this on a computer that's been built within the last 5 years. All right, so we've talked about what to, what kind of computer you would need to get it. So let's say you've got the game and you're booted up and you're wanting to know first things to do. Well, first of all, I would go into the graphics settings and I would hit advanced options and check out the settings here. And then you can even run a benchmark battle to see how your computer is going to perform. In fact, this game is so old that you'll notice that even my 16 gigabyte graphics card shows up as a 3 gigabyte graphics card because this game's so old it can't recognize more than I think 3 or 4 gigs of RAM out of a graphics card. So again, the game's old. You can adjust all your settings here, you can tinker with it, you keep running that benchmark and get it set the way that you want, and it'll give you a great opportunity to have the game running good. Now, just an example of some things that'll make a pretty big difference in graphics performance: unit size. If you have really low performance, drop this down. Like, I recommend you play on the large unit sizes. This is the one that's kind of the best balance. But feel free to drop this to medium or even small if you have to. Now, it means you're, like, let's say that there's 120 men in a unit on large. That will scale down, and in small, it'll probably be like half of that, maybe even less. So it'll make the game look different. But so unit size, typically shadows, and like water textures, stuff like that. SSAO usually hurts frame rates a whole lot and doesn't gain you a whole lot. Distortion effects. So, like, feel free to turn all this stuff off if you need to get better frame rates, and just run the benchmark until you're feeling good about what you got. That should get you set up from a graphics standpoint. So we've bought the game, we've gotten our graphics settings settled, and we're ready to play. How do we start? You'll notice that there's a lot of campaigns, especially if you own the DLCs. Always, if you're new to the game, start with the prologue, okay? Start with the prologue. It's always better this way. You need to learn how to play the game, and the Total War Rome 2 prologue is a pretty good way to do this. It kind of walks you through, it starts you out in a battle, and teaches you how to, you know, do some of the very most basic controls, and then moves you on into a limited campaign map, where it, again, teaches you the basics of using the campaign map, and how to find your way around, teaches you about income and other important things like ending a turn. And so you need to know these things, because Total War is a bit different than most strategy titles in the sense that it is a mixture of real-time strategy and turn-based strategy. The campaign map is turn-based, and the battles are real-time. So again, it mixes the two, and it teaches you these, and it kind of helps you meet an ultimate goal in the prologue campaign to feel like you've kind of grasped the basics. So do the prologue campaign, okay? Play through the Samnite Wars. It's a pretty cool historical thing, too. Don't be afraid to be new. Don't ignore this stuff. Go play it. It will help a lot. Also, if you want to learn more about how to control units and stuff in the games, I'm pretty sure I made a video on this. If I can find it, I'll go find the link to it, and I'll add the link in the description. If I haven't done it, I guarantee you someone else has done a video on how to use the controls in Rome 2. And if I can't find my own, I'll try and find you a different one, and I'll link it. Once you have finished the prologue campaign and you're wanting to learn more, let's say you're ready to learn more, if you struggled with the prologue campaign, I suggest that you don't pick any faction in the grand campaign that has an initial challenge above easy. If you didn't struggle and you really gripped the prologue campaign, you did just fine and you breezed right through it, you could probably jump up to one that is hard or normal. It's up to you, but here's my recommendation. You're new to the game. Yes, I'm the heir of Carthage and I love Carthage, but don't jump straight into Carthage. Play Rome. Rome is a much easier faction to understand. Their military units are much easier to control on the battle map. They require less micromanagement from the player. They are easier to understand. And Rome just has solid heavy infantry. And heavy infantry is a pretty easy way to win in Rome 2 when it comes to battles. And in fact, I would take it a step further and suggest that you play not only as Rome, but as the House of Julia, because there is extra conversion to your culture, which means less rebellions on the campaign map. And you get extra melee attack when you're fighting against barbarians, which is going to be like the Gauls and the Iceni and the Celts and all these others. So I think Julia is a great place to start with the Romans. Again, if you were kind of struggling, you can always, don't be afraid. Change the game difficulty to easy. What does the game difficulty do on easy? Well, when you put it on easy, it actually gives the player a few extra bonuses that technically you shouldn't get. Like, for instance, it'll make it a little easier for you to control public order. Public order is a mechanic in Total War of your settlements, and if the settlements get really bad public order, they will rebel, and you will have armies of rebels trying to take over your settlements, and it can really cause a lot of problems. If you're new to the game, having it on easy makes it less difficult for you to manage your settlements. It gives you a chance to learn how to play the game without having rebel stacks all over you and requiring you to manage a ton of stuff. So don't be afraid to use easy. Normal basically means that the player doesn't get any specific buffs or debuffs. And so that's the difference between easy and normal. And the same goes with the battle difficulty, which if you come here to the campaign settings, you can set up some settings here, battle timers, stuff like that. I thought that there was a battle difficulty setting in here, but I guess it just sets the battle difficulty based off of the game difficulty. In some newer Total Wars, it allows you to pick both, and it may in this one as well once you get into the campaign. But again, normal means that it's kind of baseline. It's not cheating for the AI. It's not cheating for you. And normal is a good place to be. But again, if you need it, play on easy. Don't be worried. No one's going to yell at you. Just learn how to play the game. Anyway, I'm going to boot up a campaign here with Rome, and I'm going to give you a couple of pointers as you get started on the campaign map.
You are at war with the Etruscan League. March north and capture their territories. This will allow you to consolidate Italia and ensure the safety of Roma. You must wage war if you hope to extend your dominion. Syracuse and Carthage own territory in Magna Graecia, so conflict with them is inevitable if you wish to expand across the Mediterranean. Otherwise, they may prove useful allies against Etruria or the Gaulish tribes to the north. Come what may, Rome will triumph.
All right, so here we are. We're in the campaign map. I've gotten a nice little intro from our advisor here, who seems to be looking rather unpleasant, like maybe he's constipated. I don't know, maybe he should drink a bottle of olive oil until it all comes out. But in any case, we're here. We're on the campaign map. It even gives you an objective. You're going to receive objectives like this in a Total War campaign. They're not required, but if you do complete them, there's typically a nice reward. Like right here, you get an extra 2,500 gold in your treasury. So, let's talk a little bit about what's in front of you, because again, this can be overwhelming for new players. If you've played the prologue campaign, you'll be in a much better position here, but I'm going to kind of speak to this as if maybe you haven't played the prologue campaign. Alright, so let's start up here in the top left. This is your advisor, and there are advice settings here when you click on these little cogs, and you can set it to audio only, text and audio, or you can just say, hey, look, I've had enough of you, I don't need your advice. If you're new, you probably shouldn't do this, but I'm not, so I'm just going to show you how that works. Up here in the top left-hand corner, you have your menu. You can go in here and take care of saves, loads, options, exiting, all that other kind of stuff. And then if we go in here to the game settings, campaign, yeah, battle advice. Yeah, see, battle difficulty, there is a slider here for it. So at any point during the game, you can change the battle difficulty. So let's say you're rolling through everybody and it's too easy. Run it up here to very hard. The computer will be getting cheats. I mean, they'll literally be making their troops stronger than they should be. Or let's say you're not doing well on normal, you can drop it down here to easy, and it'll give you a little bit of cheats to help you out as you learn the game. You can always change your battle timers, campaign advice, blah, blah, blah. So don't be afraid to use these settings. You've also got your controls in case you need any quick tips about how to do any controls. All right, so that's the menu there. And then you've got your chat. I don't know what this is really going to be for here unless you're chatting to your friends that are in game. So no big deal there. There's a Total War Encyclopedia here. If you click that Total War Encyclopedia, it opens you up here to a web page where you can navigate through the Total War Rome 2 Encyclopedia. So you can click through things, you can learn more. Feel free to use this should you feel like you need it. See, like here, we can set it to Grand Campaign and it tells you all about the map and who's there, regions, and you can do all, a whole bunch of stuff here. You can look up the manual, you can, yeah, take care of whatever you need to here in the encyclopedia. Then last but not least, we mentioned the advisor. Here's those advisor settings. I told them to shut up, but let's say that you decide you don't want them to shut up. You can uncheck the suppress advice or whatever it is that you want to do here in your advisor settings. So that's some settings up in the top left. Down here in the bottom right is a radar map, basically, of your holdings. And this little cone here shows you which direction the camera is pointing. So currently we're pointing north. Looking north over Italy. You can zoom out using your mouse scroll wheel, so you can get a little bit higher view, zoom in with the scroll wheel. WASD and D are your controls out here for moving around forward, backward, left, right. And then you can also use Z and X to change the elevations if you would like as well. If you hold the shift key, it typically increases the movement rate at which the camera pans across the screen while you're moving. So anyway, just a couple basic movement points. There's a lot of information also down here in the bottom right about your faction. This little treasure chest right here is your current treasury. We have 5,000 gold in our treasury. Gold can be used to recruit units or build buildings in your settlements, which we'll talk about in a moment. The next one is your predicted income. So if we ended this turn right now, we would have an income of 2619, meaning at the beginning of my next turn, if I didn't spend any other money, we'd have 7619 gold in our treasury. The next one is your food surplus. As of now, we have none. If your food gets too low, it can be a problem. The game has a food mechanic where you have to have enough food to feed your people, support armies, and food is also used to build up certain building chains in your settlement. If it goes in the negative, there are, you know, bad effects. If it goes in the positive, there are good effects like increased population growth. Next to that, it is the season and the year in which you're playing. So you can see this campaign starts in 272 BC and we are in the summer. So that's the information down here at the bottom. Now, to be very helpful to you in a campaign, there are several options here for you. Event messages. So anything that you saw on screen, like your objective, like, dang, what was I supposed to do? Click on the event messages and you'll see it here. You can click on it and you can check out any messages that came to you during the last turn. The next one over is all of your armies and agents. And if you have an army, So let's say here, it'll call it, for Rome, obviously it's Legio 1, is the name of this one, Italica. You can actually rename this stuff too, by the way, it's pretty fun. But so you can quickly navigate to all of your troops, navies, and agents, like the spy, from this menu. I recommend using this. A lot of people don't know about this, and they're always swinging around the map. And use this forces tab to quickly navigate all your forces. And you can see over here, this little green bar is their movement points. And when it's full, it means, hey, these people haven't been moved. Maybe I should use them on this turn rather than waste them. All right, so make sure you keep track of that. This is the number of troops that are in each one. So our larger legion is the Legio 2 Questris here. It's got 1,280 soldiers in it. And then when you click on an army or force, you can see its composition down here in the unit cards. These are called unit cards. Our commander is Lucius Libo. He's the dictator of Rome right now, and which is a position in one of the offices. He is in a general and bodyguard unit, and we get information about this unit by either right-clicking it. It will put us up in front of us. It'll give you a rundown. Hey, it's disciplined. Well, what does that mean? It means it doesn't suffer any morale penalty when the general dies. Encourages other nearby units. It can hide in a forest. Here's its melee attack. So all of the attack and stuff in battle in Total War is kind of a dice roll, and this explains to you how those dice rolls are going to work. It even tells you how much it costs to recruit this unit, how much it's costing you each turn to upkeep it. So this costs us 90 gold per turn as long as this unit is serving us. So you can get good information. That information is also available over there on the left, as you can see. And if I click the unit, it will pin it where I can come over here and look at the stats quickly. We can see those special stats over here. You can see the other units in your army. It tells you the type of infantry they are. So like, for instance, this little the square, I guess rotated square, diamond, whatever we want to call it, with the sword in the middle, is a medium melee infantry. When you mouse over it, the tooltip tells you that. So Astati, medium melee infantry. And you can see here we got Velites, which it tells us are a very light missile infantry. Missile infantry is a ranged unit. And then we've got also these levies, which are also very light missile infantry. So light is the weight class of a unit. Typically, you know, the heavier a unit is, the more bruising it is in melee combat, but also the slower it is on the battlefields. So anyway, that's our unit's cards. As far as some other things down here that you can use, you can look at the details of this force by clicking here. This shows us the force details. You get traditions, so as this force wins battles, you'll be able to add traditions to them, which give them, you know, better attack, ability to create better siege engines, to move farther on the campaign map. It'll give you a lot of options, and you can see that here. If we go to the general details, and let's say you want to know more about old Julius Libo here, this tells you the different traits that he has, any household retainers, and right now he has this acid-tongued wife, so apparently he gets to take a real tongue-lashing from his wife every time he's at home, and she likes to badmouth everybody else out in the public forum, and this takes away from his authority. It makes it a little bit harder for him to lead. However, it makes it a little better from military presence, I guess, because everybody is scared of this dude's wife when he's around. He has this Libertas in his skills, and it basically gives him the ability to inspire troops, which is a click ability. You can click on troops in battle. And it also means that there's less slave unrest in any province where he's at. So, again, nice details there. If you're looking at an agent, you can get to the agent details here. Let's say that you don't like Julius Libo and you want to replace him. You can do so by clicking the replace button, picking his replacement, then clicking hire and sending Julius Libo off to be completely embarrassed and fired and begging for money on the streets of Rome. So feel free should you get tired of Julius and you want something different. So anyway, that is our details tab. Let's say that you want Julius to have a stronger army. You click here on this Recruit Units button, and you can bring more units in. Now, this will depend. Typically, you're going to need to be in friendly territory to pull this off, unless you're hiring mercenaries, which is different. I'll show you in a moment. But these are the troops that we can recruit. The troops that you can recruit are dictated by the buildings that are available in your province. If you build better military buildings, then you should be able to recruit higher-tier troops. But let's say that we want some more of those Hastati, or we want some Rorri here, which are a spear-armed infantry, or more skirmishers. We can click on them and the recruitment process will begin, and you'll see a nice little icon pop up here which is indicating that Julius is in the process of recruiting more troops. You can see he's clenched his fist and started squatting strangely, like he's really trying hard to squeeze one out because he's still constipated. But yeah, in any case, that's what he's up to. So he's now recruiting. We talked a little bit about the army. There's one last thing here I want to show you down on the army list, which is hire mercenaries. Let's say that you need some troops right now and you're willing to pay top dollar coin for them because you need some help immediately. Mercenary system is pretty cool in Rome 2. It's available depending on what province you're in. There are certain types of mercenaries you can hire. They cost a lot to upkeep and hire, so but you get them immediately. So let's say that he immediately needs some spears and old Julius is willing to hire these Italian mercenaries. You click on them and you hire. If it's grayed out, it means they're not available to be hired. We're going to make the hire, and now Julius has some mercenary Italian spearmen in his army to help fight with him so he can gather forces quickly. So that is pretty much the army controls. If you need to move an army on the campaign map, you can't be recruiting and move. So let's say that you want to stop recruiting and move. I'm going to click on this Hestati, and I want to move Julius. I basically left-click him to select him, and then you right-click where you want them to move. The yellow indicates their movement range, so you can see this yellow outline here. I could move almost all the way up to Velathri, which is controlled by the Etruscan League. And you can also tell by the red border here. The yellow border means we're in our own territory, and the red border means that you would be entering enemy territory. And then if you mouse over an army, you can tell that you are at war with them because it tells you this is an army of the Etruscan League. It's an enemy army led by Aurelius Tyrannus, or Tyrannus, whatever it is. So you could attack them by right-clicking. If you see an enemy force and you want to attack them, select your own force, right-click the enemy force, and you can lead an attack. This generates an attack screen here, and you can choose what to do. You can run away like a coward with your tail tucked between your legs. You can fight the battle manually with you controlling it, or you can auto-resolve the battle and basically just say, hey, I trust you, computer. You can make the right choices here. Now, this is a risky one. However, with our strength being this high, the red is the chances of old... what's his bucket here? I can't remember his name right now. Publius Aurelius Tyrannus. He is not likely to win this battle. That's what the red shows here. And the yellow is our strength of arms. So the auto-resolve's pretty safe here. I'm going to click it. And for anything that is very sure, you can click this, and you can see here that we can be very aggressive, and we expect to have basically this. None of these change anything right here, but you can be very aggressive. It'll show you, does it change your win chance? Does it change the type of victory or the predicted outcome? If you mouse over these, it'll show that to you, and you can check that each time. I'll be aggressive here. Julius really wants to show off his prowess to the Roman Senate. He wants to be more than a dictator one day. He wants to be an emperor. So he is showing how aggressive he is. And then you can decide what to do with your enemies afterwards. We could be nice and we could release the captives, maybe give them some flowers, tell them sorry, and say, hey, look, you know, it's okay. Sometimes people lose. Don't worry about it. Go home, pat yourself on the back, have this nice little participation trophy, okay? Or you could say, you know what, I'm not going to release you. I'm in fact going to enslave you. And see, it tells you you're going to gain wealth from doing this, but if you get too many captives, they can be bad for public order. As you can imagine, people don't typically take well to being enslaved, imprisoned, and forced into labor against their will. So bear that in mind as well. Over time, that could be bad. And then you can just kill the captives. So we gain a little bit of wealth because, you know, we're going to loot them real good after we kill them. However, this is going to make sure that your enemy, I mean, really hates your guts. They're like, man, they just killed all the captives. So, again, let's say that Julius is trying to impress the Roman Senate, and he's going to kill all the captives. So our faction is going to be real impressed with our prowess, and of course the Etruscan League is going to be none too happy with us. You'll also notice here that I took some casualties during that auto-resolve. See, 136 out of 160, so I've lost a few units. They cannot replenish because I'm in enemy territory. If you can replenish, you'll see this little plus sign up here on your unit card. There you go. A little bit of introduction into armies and how they work. Let's take a look at our agents. If you have an agent, you can find them here in the forces and agents, and it'll have a little icon here, and this one is a spy. We can send our spy off to scout the way ahead of us. You can see they have quite a lot more movement points than your typical unit. And let's say I'm really curious what the Etruscan League is up to outside of Ariminum. So I'm going to move my spy forward and try and get eyes on what is going on in that region. So I right-clicked and my spy begins moving. and I can see that there is no enemy army in Ahriemenum right now. In fact, it's pretty desolate. You'll notice that there's actually a little cross here when I mouse over Ahriemenum too, and it's because our spy can take actions against this settlement. So if I right-click it, all right, I have one option at the moment, which is Settlement Sabotage. If I click that, we can reconnoiter. So we have a 45% chance of success. It breaks that down a little more in the tooltips there if you hold the mouse over it. It cost me 337 gold to do it. Let's tell my spy to go ahead and do some reconnoitering. They will never know I was there. And our spy was really bad and was wounded in the process of reconnoitering. So we'll have to give Posthumius Scapula a better training next time, because she just wasn't able to get the job done, so we failed, and we'll have to accept her failure, though the Roman Senate will not look kindly upon this, and she will no doubt be disgraced and no longer allowed to eat at the world's first Taco Bell in Rome, which is a big deal, by the way, folks. All right, so let's move on to settlements. If you want to, you can click this Provinces tab. I suggest you use the Provinces tab. It quickly helps you navigate around the map. If you want to see your provinces, they are listed in the top. You can click on them, and it takes you straight to their capital. So we have Italia and Magna Graecia. And Magna Graecia's capital is Brundisium. And you can see all of the different settlements down here. When you click on a province, you can see the individual settlements. And if you want to go straight to that settlement, you again click the name. Here we are at Roma. Go to Neapolis, which is also under our control, because you can see the building browsers and stuff. Ahriemenum, which is under control of the Etruscan League, and Velathri, which is also under control of the Etruscan League. And it tells you that. You can mouse over and see, and you can look to see whether you have any intelligence on what's going on there by mousing over this as well. So it tells you what buildings you know are there, and public order issues, all that other kind of stuff. So anyway, this is very handy for navigating around the map. Let's say you want to keep an eye on your enemy, like Carthage, Carthaginensis. So see, we can click here. We have no details. It's under the fog of war. Macedonia, under the fog of war as well. Africa, fog of war. So we can't really keep tabs on everything, but we do have the ability to kind of see what's going on out here at Corsica, at Sardinia. We can see that we have the Etruscan League out here at Alalia, and we have Carthage at Carolus. So this is a way to navigate around the map quickly, get a feel for what's around you, and be aware of your enemies. So anyway, good stuff there. We've kind of seen how to use the Provinces tab. Let's pick Italia and look at Rome. And this is the building browser that's going to show us what is in our settlement. Rome is currently a pretty diminutive city at the moment. It's not grown very much, and it's up to you as the player to do that. Now, you can improve the orange building you see here is a main settlement building, and you get different benefits and stuff from it. You can see here it helps provide a garrison. It can unlock recruitment of levy units, basically like Rory and levies. It generates a certain amount of wealth and growth. But this little chevron here on it tells you that it can also be upgraded at the moment. So we could upgrade it into a civil colonia, which will take food that we don't have, by the way, because remember, we looked at our food down here. But be careful of that. It takes food, but this one gives us even more growth, gives us more wealth from subsistence. It does not change the levy in any significant way, but it gives us additional wealth. And so civil colonia is basically a more economic focused option for the Roman settlement here. Or we can go with the garrison colonia, which also is going to take food. It doesn't give us as much public order because the people don't like having the military stuff all over them, but it does give us a better garrison. You can see that it plops a unit, it changes our levies up to velites, and then adds Hestati into the garrison as well. So it's going to give us a stronger garrison, which means there's a bigger force here, and it's easier for Rome to defend itself if your army isn't present. So you have to make choices like this, and if you want to know more about those buildings, you can right-click it, and you can follow the building tree all the way down and see what this is going to do as you build down those trees. So don't be afraid to use that right-click, mouse over anything. There's pretty good tool tips in Rome 2. So you get a feeling for your settlement. Let's say you want to add a building. This white slot here means that there's undeveloped land. You can click on this nice little hammer here to expand your city. It is now expanded. If you don't build anything here, this will turn into slums, which is something I often forget to do in my own campaign, and then the slums have a negative effect on your your settlement, and I will show you how to look at that here shortly. Let's say, you know what, Rome is a nice place, but it needs a little more entertainment. It needs a little more free speech, right? So we're going to build a public forum. This will make people happy because they can come, enjoy the nice public forum, and it brings in some nice traders. People want a hot dog stand. They want to be able to get a snow cone. So we're going to build this public forum. It gives us some extra wealth and public order. It should make Rome a little bit happier. It cost us 700 gold. Hey, we've got the gold. Let's invest. Let's make the people happy. When we click on it, you can see it's going to take 2 turns for this building to complete. Excellent. We're on the way to greatness. Rome is going to have its first hot dog vendors, and so we will be happy. Anyway, that gives you a little bit of an idea about how to build a building. Now, there's some other options down here, similar to like with an army. You can see the details tab. It tells us how much income Rome is making, and then the other settlements in this province. It tells you the public order of the province. Right now, it is at zero, but it's improving. The taxes are not great at the moment. You know, could be better in terms of the way things are going on, but you can mouse over all this, and it tells you more information. It is 100% Latin culture, so we're not dealing with issues of people like fighting over culture. Again, the income, all that type of stuff. If you need to raise a new army, you can click on Raise Forces, and you can hire another general to go compete with Julius. So maybe you don't want to replace him, but you want to scare him a little and hire another army, or you just need more troops. This is where you do it. You can raise an army, you can raise a fleet, or you can reinstate an army that was destroyed. So let's say that Julius gets his army destroyed, and you want to bring it back to have that name, but you want to make fun of Julius by putting a different leader in there. You can do that here. You can also recruit agents here. Let's say you need another spy or new agents when they become available. You can see these ones are not available because we have not researched the appropriate options yet. So that is how you manage your settlements. Use that province tab, and then that gives you a basic rundown. There is one more tab here, which is factions. You can use this to quickly get an idea of the factions that are around you. We got the RDA, Athens, Carthage. The little head here tells you how much they like you right now, which is not at all for basically everybody. In fact, Carthage, Epirus, and the Etruscan League straight up hate us. The swords mean they are at war with you. So this gives you a quick view of some of that. Now, there are other ways to view this, and so we will take a look at that as we move along. But anyway, there's your little controls above the map. They're all very handy. There's one last thing you can do here, which is the strategic overview, and this will give you a larger map where you can kind of see the political borders and the different settlements and armies, if there's enemy armies on here, the different resources, factions, all that kind of stuff, so it gives you great information. You can do some different, see like political party affiliation, like it breaks down the different support within Rome of the political party affiliation. You got House of Julia, Cornelia, Junia, so it just gives you an idea what you're up against in terms of political parties within your faction. And then you got faction ownership is what we were on, so this one shows you if it's Etruscan League, so on. And then we're going to have diplomatic status, so red means we are enemies, white is neutral, so this is a quick way to kind of see who's around you. Public order, you know, if it's green, you're doing good, if it's red, you're doing poorly. And then you got wealth, so the wealthiest regions are going to show up in like a yellow color, the poorer regions in the red. And then we've also got growth. Really bright green is good. It means things are growing, your population's getting larger. So you can use that map. Now, last couple things before we head on. This is not going to teach you everything, and I do want to get into a quick battle just to kind of give you a few basic controls. But last couple things here. You got your faction overview. There's a lot of stuff in here. I'm not going to cover all of this at the moment, but it gives you a faction summary, the type of government you are, the name of your faction, shows you the progress towards your goals, your culture, the different traits you have as a faction, who you're at war with, trade partners, all that kind of stuff. Politics is in here. I'm not going to go into politics right now because this is way too deep of a discussion, and we will cover this maybe at another time, or you can find a video where someone's done that. Characters, so your family tree, you should be able to find people in here like Julius, who is looking to make his way into the Roman world. Yeah, here he is, Julius Libo. So you can see him, see how he is tied to your family tree and what his ancestry is. And if he has children, you'll be able to see all that. And then there's records, which keeps track of your progress in the campaign.